read scripture from. Psalms 51. Starting at verse 1. Have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy loving kindness, according unto the multitude of thy tender mercies. Blot out my transgressions, wash me thoroughly from mine iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I acknowledge my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against thee, the holy, have I sinned, and done this evil in thy sight, that thou mightst be justified when thou speakest and be clear. When thou judgest, behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and sin did my mother conceive me. Behold, thou dearest truth in the inward parts, and in the hidden parts thou shalt make me to know wisdom. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Make me to hear joy and gladness, that that the bones which thou hast broken may rejoice. Hide thy face from my sins, and blot out all mine iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not the Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and uphold me with thy free spirit.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Does anybody have a song blessed today?
About victory in Jesus. In the Red Book, Exodus 2:17.
With his redeeming blood, he loved
the cleansing flood. I heard about a mansion he has built for me in glory. And I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea. About the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood.
Amen.
Have you ever thought about how many people over the years have sung it? Just this one song, 1939, the date, copyright date.
Amen.
You know, over the years, all these people that sung his old songs, and they still mean the same now as they did then.
That's right, amen.
Wow.
Does anybody have a testimony?
You know, lots of times we'll sing the words, but that we don't really think about what they mean. You know?
Right.
That's right.
And I just want to praise God and thank him for another day of life. He took care of me all week, took care of my family all week.
Amen.
I just want to praise his holy name. I want to thank him for the wonderful privilege that we have of being able to come here to his house today and glorify his name. And that's what we come here for. It's just like the little song that the kids sing. I don't know what you came to do, but I came to praise the Lord.
Amen.
And I want to praise his holy name and thank him for all his blessings.
Amen.
He gives me every day.
Praise the Lord.
If I tried to count my blessings, I couldn't do it. I just couldn't do it all in one day. And I just want to thank him for everything that he does.
Amen. Amen.
I felt like I've been tripping on myself all morning long just to get here.
Bless you, brother.
You know?
Yeah. I was actually looking forward to coming to church today.
Bless
and it's
Lord.
Been a while since I have looked forward to coming to church.
Bless
Amen.
The Lord.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Thank
you,
Jesus.
Can we see 1 of 4 in the Moles book?
The devil sends all kinds of darts, don't he? Trying to keep you away from church, saying, oh, come on, you don't need to go today.
Yep.
It's kind of rainy outside. It's cold. Let's just stay home.
Yeah. Well, you think about years ago, when people were walking, you know, like my dad, you know, or walking to church.
Moms.
People don't want to walk outside if there's a little bit of snow on the ground anymore. They love their church when there's a snowstorm or something.
I'll wait for the DVD.
Bless you.
We walk, but we didn't walk far, but we
yeah.
walk.
I am blessed every day that I live. I am blessed when I wake up in the morning till I lay my head to rest. I am blessed, I am blessed through the sunshine and rain, even sorrow and Jesus is still my comfort and God, and his love comforts me, and his grace to set me free, and someday I shall stand by his side. I am blessed, I am blessed every day that I live. I am up in the morning till I lay my head to rest. I am blessed, I am blessed on this earth. They are mine by my new birth, and we shall share in that home beyond the sky. I am blessed every day that I live. I am blessed when I wake up in the morning till I lay my head to rest. I am blessed. I am blessed.
Kimmy wanted to know if we could sing 228 in the Redwood.
Yes, Lord, absolutely.
Sometimes I don't carry the tune very good, but you know what? It's beautiful when the ears of the Lord.
Yeah,
the Bible just says make a joyful noise. And God doesn't care what it sounds like.
This is Ron Rusty's favorite song here.
Rock of ages, clap for me. Let me hide myself in thee. Let the water and the blood from thy wounded side which flow be of sin the double cure. Save from wrath and make me pure. Could my tears forever flow? Could my zeal no longer know? These for sin could not atone. Thou and thou alone, in my hand no price I bring. Simply to thy cross I cling, while I draw this fleeting breath. When my eyes shall close in death, when I rise to worlds unknown, and behold thee on thy throne, Rock of ages, cleft for me, let me hide myself in thee.
Amen.
Does anybody have a prayer request?
I have quite a few prayer requests this morning. That John was to fly back to Florida today. Pray that he'll have a safe flight. And, I hear that Jim McAllister had had surgery for cancer. And Brother Doyle Means, pray for all the Means family. Doyle passed away Friday morning. He's the one that preached here the night that all of them come, probably wanted to come. And pray for them. And the ones that's not here this morning, I don't know what's happened to Mike. Pray for him, Leona, and Bob and Gail. And let's really thank him for Roger and him.
Amen. Bless the Lord.
Well, my sister's been put on a ventilator, and she's all right. She's ready to go to heaven. Amen. But I would ask you to pray for her family.
Amen. Yeah.
Because most of them are lost. And, just pray for them.
Remember Bob and Gail? Bob called and said that he had to take Gail to the hospital here yesterday. I wasn't for sure what was wrong, but Lord knows.
And pray for Bill. You know, he's still in Florida, and he's in church with our other son today. So I just want to praise God for that. And just pray for his safe return home.
There was a fella out on the ridge. I didn't know him. I knew some of his family. He's a Bryant Robin might remember him, but I can't remember his first name. Brian, he had a gas can blow up on him the other day, and he was in the hospital, and he died a couple of days later. He just had three or four kids and had a three-month-old little baby.
Was it Travis, was it?
No.
I heard it on the news, but I can't remember his name.
Okay. He had a nickname. He graduated in 90 or 91. He was a year or two older than you. I want to say Tinker, but it's not Tinker.
Brian was his first name?
No, Brian was his last name. I can't think of his name, but it was... I'll think of it later. That boy that I went to school with, he had his leg taken off. I pray for him and his family.
Almighty Heavenly Father, Lord my God, my Savior, my Redeemer, I praise you, Father. Lord, what a privilege, Father God, Lord, that we can bow before your presence. Father God, Lord, that we can call on your holy name, dear Lord, at any time, Father. And Lord God, we just praise you, dear Lord God, for all, every soul that's here this morning, Father. And Lord God, we just thank you, dear Lord, to be able to pray together, Father. Lord God, that we come before you, dear Lord, as your children, dear Lord. And Father, we just thank you, Father God, Lord, for every request, Father God. Lord, we just thank you for the concerns that you put on our heart for one another, dear Lord. For you told us, dear Lord, that people would know that we were your disciples if we had love for one another, Father. And Lord, I just pray this morning, Father God, Lord, that you would just help each and every one, dear Lord. Help those especially, dear Lord God, that are lost. Dear Lord, use us, I pray. Lord, use whatever it takes, dear Lord, that they would be saved, Father. Lord, that they would hear of the goodness and taste of the goodness of Jesus, Father. Lord God, that they would want to come and worship him, dear Lord. That they would want to come and hear more about Jesus, Father God. And Lord, we just pray, Father, we pray for those that are sick, dear Lord. Those that have been mentioned, Father, that have had surgery and those that are in the hospital, Father. Lord, we just pray that you would show your glory and, Father, that you would help them, dear Lord God, that they would know that you are the great physician, that, dear Lord God, you created us, Father, and that, Lord God, that you can heal anything, Father God. And Lord, we just thank you for Jesus. We thank you for the testimony, dear Lord, of his wonderful works that he did, Father. And Lord, I just praise you that he continues to work on us, Father. Lord, that the greatest miracle of all is the new birth, Father. And Lord God, how you help us, dear Lord God, to repent from sin and help us, Father God, Lord, to walk in the paths of righteousness, Father. Lord, we just pray, help us, dear Lord God, to be a blessing, dear Lord. Help us, I pray, dear Lord God, that we might be able to give you glory, Father, Lord, in the short time that we're here. Thank you, my Father God, Lord, for all that you do and all that you make possible, Father. And Lord, we give you the praise in Jesus' name. And amen.
Amen.
Does anybody have a song request?
How about Heaven's Jubilee? I'm not sure what number it is. It's 298. 298 in the blue book. Some glad morning we shall see Jesus in the air, coming after you and me, joys ours to share. What rejoicing there will be when the saints shall rise, headed for that jubilee yonder in the skies. Oh, what singing, oh, what shouting, on that happy morning when we all shall rise. Oh, what glory, hallelujah,
when we meet our blessed Savior in the skies. Seems that now I almost see all the sainted dead rising for that jubilee that is just ahead. In the twinkling of an eye, change with them to be all the living saints to fly to that jubilee. Oh, what singing, oh, what shouting on that happy morning when we all shall rise. Oh, what glory, hallelujah, when we meet our blessed Savior in the skies. When with all the heavenly hosts we begin to sing, singing in the Holy Ghost, how the heavens will ring. Millions there will join the song, with them we shall be, praising Christ through ages long, heaven's jubilee. Oh, what singing, oh, what shouting on that happy morning when we all shall rise. Oh, what glory, hallelujah, when we meet our blessed Savior in the skies.
Chapter 10.
Whosoever will be great among you shall be your minister.
And whosoever of your of you will be the chiefest shall be servant of all. For even the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister and to give his life a ransom for many.
So what have we been talking about the past few weeks?
Being a servant.
Okay, well, now we're going to start growing in worship, okay? All right. Now, we've got a new memory verse. And we're going to read this. You can turn your Bibles if you want to, or you can just read it from here, okay? Let's read it together first, and then we're going to do a little something with it. Matthew 1:21. And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Okay, and what we're going to do is, we're going to take turns, and you get to come up here, erase a word, erase just one word, and then we're going to see if we can say it without that word being there. Okay? But we have to say, like if I marked out Jesus, call his name, and then when we get there, we have to say Jesus. We have to try to remember it, okay? Let's say it one more time before we do that. 1:21, and she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Okay, who wants to go first? All right, Ray? Just erase one word, okay? Matthew 1:21, and she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Good. All right, let's go next. On. I have an eraser somewhere, but I cannot find it. Matthew 1:21, and she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Russell. Matthew 1:21, and she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Matthew 1:21, and she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Good job.
You go again.
You want to do the whole thing? Well, just see if you can say it.
Matthew 1:21, and she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus.
For he shall save his people from their sins. Good. All right. Now, the memory passage tells us that an angel had an important message for Mary and Joseph. Mary and Joseph were going to be parents to a baby that was so special that an angel was sent to be sure that they gave him the right name, Jesus. The name Jesus means the Lord saves. Jesus was coming to bring salvation, to save his people from their sins. This is a good reason to worship, isn't it? Okay. All right. In this cup, what do you all see?
Clear water.
It's clear water. When we're born, we don't have a whole lot of decisions to make. Whoever takes care of us decides what we're going to eat, what we wear, where we go. They decide everything for us. Then as we get older, we begin to make these decisions on our own. That means we're growing up. Huh?
Babies are so lucky.
Yeah. All right, we choose what to wear. We choose what to eat sometimes. We choose what to read, who to talk to, and what music we want to listen to. Now, I hope you guys make the right decisions about those things. But sometimes we make decisions that aren't good, such as disobeying our parents, being hurtful to people, arguing with people, gossiping, lying, stealing. These bad decisions stain us and they make us dirty. They stain us with sin. Our lives are no longer clean like this. They're stained and dirty. So each, or just one time that we sin, and we'll put in just one drop of food coloring. Okay, that's one sin. Is that water clean anymore? It's not clean anymore. Just that one little sin colored that whole cup to be red. Jesus wanted to give us a way to make our lives clean again. He wanted us to be forgiven of our sins. He wanted to get this sin out of there. That's what the gift of salvation is. Jesus forgiving our sins and making us clean. Okay? Now this is going to represent Jesus' blood. Okay? Jesus' blood, when we add it to our lives, look what's happening. Is the water red anymore?
Yep. Mm-mm.
It's going clear again. Jesus' blood makes us clean. It washes those sins away. Now, this for the next few weeks, we're going to be growing in worship. Worship is a word that means telling God how special He is. Praising God. The story of Jesus' birth, the birth of the Savior, is one of the most special reasons why we worship God. Even though we do things to make our lives dirty with sin, God gave us a way to be forgiven through Jesus. Okay? We're going to do a little skit. I need you girls, if you all would. Ladies, would you all take a little part in it? I just want you to be narrators. You don't have to go anywhere. Can you share off each other? Okay. You're Brittany's narrator one and you're narrator two. Okay, now you'll listen and then you guys are going to have parts. Autumn, you are Elizabeth. Okay? She just has one line right there. Ray, you're going to be the cousin. Do you want a part, Tommy?
Mommy.
Huh? No, you're going to be the cousin and the neighbor. Okay? Rusty, you're Zachariah. Okay? Now, this is exactly the scripture. I just pasted it into a skit. So you can actually, if you don't have a page, you can follow along in your Bible. It's from Luke 1, 57 through 75. Okay? All right.
Now Elizabeth's full time came that she should be delivered, and she brought forth a son. And her neighbors and her cousins heard, now the Lord has shewed great mercy upon her. And they rejoiced with her. And it came to pass that on the eighth day,
they came to circumcise the child, and they called him Zechariah, after the name of his father. And his mother answered and said,
"Not so, but he shall be called John."
And they said unto her,
"There is none of the kindred that is called by this name."
And they made sense to his father how he would have called him. And he asked for the writing table and wrote, saying, "His name is John." And they marveled all. And his mouth was open immediately, and his tongue was, and he spake and praised God. And fear came on all that dwelt round about them. And all these things were noised abroad throughout all the hill country of
Judea.
And all they that heard them laid them up in their hearts, saying,
"What manner of child shall these be? This be, and the hand of the Lord was with him."
And his father Zechariah was filled with the Holy Ghost and prophesied, saying,
"Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he hath visited and redeemed his people, and hath raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of the servant of David, as he spake by the mouth of his holy prophets, which have been since the world began, that we would be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all that hate us, to perform the mercy promised to our father, and remember his being delivered out of the hand of our enemies, might serve him and without fear and holiness and righteousness before him all the days of our life. And thou child shalt be called the prophet of highest, for thou shalt go before the face of the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation unto his people by the ransom of our sins through the tender mercy of God, whereby the day spring on high that hath visited us, to give light to them that sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace."
And the child grew and waxed strong in spirit, and was the deserts till the day of his shewing unto Israel.
Good, thank you. Alright. Having a baby is a pretty exciting time, isn't it? We just got a new nephew. Mama got a new great-grandson just a couple weeks ago. It's pretty exciting. Zechariah and Elizabeth were old. So, I mean, how much more exciting do you think it was for them? Would it be real exciting? Okay. It was so exciting that when Zechariah had the chance to respond to God's message by obeying God and calling his son John, that's all that people wanted them to name the baby Zechariah, because they wanted him to name the baby after him. But he was obeying God. God had told him to name him John. when he was he obeyed God and called his name John, he was suddenly able to speak because his tongue had been tied. We didn't read that part. Why did he close his mouth and not able him to speak?
He didn't believe.
Did he laugh?
Yeah, he didn't believe.
When he heard that they were going to have a baby, that when God told him they were going to have a baby, he laughed. So his tongue, he couldn't speak. But then when he obeyed God by saying his name was John, then he was suddenly able to speak again. The first thing he did was to praise God. Hear that whole big thing that Rusty read? He was praising God. That whole part. Zechariah realized that God had done something great. He gave Zechariah and Elizabeth a son when they were old. So he worshiped God for what he had done. This scripture also includes a prophecy about Jesus saving his people from their sins. How does it make you feel that Jesus came to save us? Are you glad that Jesus came to save us? When we recognize what God has done for us, like providing our salvation or allowing Zechariah and Elizabeth to have a son, we ought to worship God. There are ways, different ways that you can worship God. You can worship God by singing. You can worship God by testifying. You can worship God by lifting your hands up, by shouting, by crying. There are many ways that you can worship God. However, God puts it on your heart to worship Him. That's what you should do. God does things for us every day, even beyond sending Jesus to die for our sins. He does things every single day that we should worship Him for. We need to look for those things and recognize them. Then we need to worship Him for who He is and what He's done. Now, during Christmas, it's easy to be thankful for the things that God has done. It's everywhere, you know. Praise the Lord. Joy to the world. But we should be that way every day.
Amen.
We should be that way not just at Christmas time. We should always be praising God. We should always be saying joy to the world and being thankful for Him every single day. But just as Zechariah's prophecy looked forward to God sending salvation to His people, we need to look forward to our future in heaven with God because of the salvation that Jesus has provided for us. Jesus brought us salvation by dying on the cross and from raising from the dead. And when we realize what God has done, we can worship Him for who He is and for what He's done. Okay, now let's see if we can go through our memory verse again. Without the words on here. You guys think you can do it now?
Matthew 1:31.
And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Okay, let's do it without looking. Matthew 1:21. And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. That's hard.
Just listen to the baby.
Yeah, and I'm looking at it, and I'm not showing it to them. That's pretty bad. All right, let's try it again. All right. Matthew 1:21. And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Next week, we'll mark out more words again. We'll just leave this one here, okay? All right, you guys want to sing? What y'all want to sing?
Possible
chariot.
Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges, Ruth, 1st and 2nd Samuel, 1st and 2nd Kings, 1st and 2nd Chronicles, Ezra, Nehemiah, Esther, Job, Psalms and Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Lamentations, Ezekiel, Daniel, Hosea, Joel, Amos, Obadiah, Jonah, Micah, Nahum, Habakkuk, Zephaniah, Haggai, Zechariah, Malachi, Matthew, Mark, Luke,
Romans, First and Second Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, First and Second Thessalonians, First and Second Timothy, Titus, Philemon, Hebrews, James, First and Second Peter, First John, Second John, Third John, Jude and Revelation.
Good job. All right, now we'll sing Gospel Chariot.
We will roll the gospel chariot along. We will roll the gospel chariot along. We will roll the gospel chariot along. But we can't hang on behind. If the preacher's in the road, we will stop and pick him up. If the preacher's in the road, we will stop and pick him up. If the preacher's in the road, we will stop and pick him up. But we can't hang on behind. If the devil's in the road, we will roll right over him. If the devil's in the road, we will roll right over him. If the devil's in the road, we will roll right over him. But we can't hang on behind.
The wise man built his house upon the rock, and the rains came tumbling down. The rains came down as the floods came up. The rains came down as the floods came up. The rains came down as the floods came up, and the house on the rock stood firm. The foolish man built his house upon the sand. The foolish man built his house upon the sand. The foolish man built his house upon the sand, and the rains came tumbling down. The rains came down as the floods came up. The rains came down as the floods came up. The rains came down as the floods came up, and the house on the sand went splash! So build your house on the Lord Jesus Christ. So build your house on the Lord Jesus Christ. So build your house on the Lord Jesus Christ, and the blessings will come down. The blessings come down as the prayers go up. The blessings come down as the prayers go up. The blessings come down as the prayers go up. So build your house on the Lord Jesus Christ.
Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing part? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless are they white as snow, are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you walking daily by the Savior's side? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Do you rest each moment in the crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of man? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? When the bridegroom cometh, will your robes be white, pure and white in the blood of the Lamb? Will your soul be ready for the mansion's bride? Oh, be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Lay aside the garments that are stained with sin, and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. There's a fountain flowing for the soul unclean. Oh, be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
I'm gonna play a song and something to listen to and consider and just to imagine how this is going to be like. What the song sings here.
On that resurrection morning, when the redeemed are gathering in, I'll be in that royal number when he calls. I'll cry.
to seeing Jesus.
Amen.
I'm looking forward that what the place that he's prepared for us, that our faith is going to end in sight.
Amen.
And I'm looking forward to the day that I can see the nail prints in his hands.
Yeah.
And that I can see, I'm going to get to see, the Bible says that we'll be known as we were known. I'm going to see my grandmother.
Amen.
I'm going to, glory be to God, I'm going to get to see Jimmy Means that used to lead service here. And, you know, I think we'll get to sing the same songs that we got to sing. I think we'll be able to sing the God on the mountain as a God in the valleys. Amen. I'm looking forward to that day. Look with me, if you would, at Luke chapter 15. Luke chapter 15, and this is one of my favorites. You know, I'm glad that everything in the Word of God is pure. I'm glad that everything in the Word of God is true. I'm glad that everything in the Word of God, brother, is good, and it's for our edification. The Bible tells us that the Scriptures are given that we may be thoroughly furnished unto good works. That all Scripture is given by God, by inspiration of God, and it's for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be thoroughly furnished unto good works. God didn't just equip us a little bit to be able to do the things in this world that he would want us to do in his will. God has thoroughly furnished us. God has thoroughly equipped us, and I'm so glad for that. I'm glad that God gives us everything that we need to be able to accomplish his will. And I thank God this morning that for the reason why that Jesus came to this world. I thank God for that blessed scripture that the Lord taught through Robin this morning. That it says that thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. You know what that tells me? You know, I don't have to go to a dictionary to try to figure out what the name of a word means. I don't have to do that because the Bible will define itself. That's what it said right there. It defined the name Jesus. That's what that scripture right there does. It defines his name. And it says, for thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. That tells me that the name Jesus means Savior.
Mm-hmm.
Savior is what his name means. You know what the Bible tells me? It says that his name is the Lord Jesus Christ. That means, the Lord means that he is master. He is master. He is God Almighty. Jesus means he is Savior. He's the Savior of this world. And Christ means that he is the soon coming King. He is the Messiah. He is King of Kings.
Amen.
And he's Lord of Lords. And I'm glad he's my Savior.
Amen.
Amen. That's what this world needs. This world don't need a teacher. This world, glory be to God, doesn't need those things. The world needs a Savior. Amen. Jesus came to save us. Hallelujah. I'm so glad to be saved this morning. It's good to be saved. Hallelujah. I'm glad that the gospel is good news. That's simply what it means, is good news. The proverb says that as cold waters to a thirsty soul, so is good news from a far country. Amen. God sent Jesus to bring good news from a far country. Hallelujah. Aren't you glad for the good news this morning? 1 Corinthians chapter 15 says that he was buried and that he died and that he rose again. And this is the gospel which I declare unto you. That's the gospel, is that Jesus died and was buried and that he rose again. That's the gospel. And plain and simple, he died for our sins. I'm so glad that he didn't just die for our sins, aren't you? Aren't you glad that he didn't just die? Amen. Aren't you glad that they buried him? Amen. When they said, give us a sign, Lord. Give us a sign that we know who you are. He says, no sign's going to be given you, but the sign of the prophet Jonah. He said, as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the whale's belly, so also shall the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth. Amen. And they buried him.
in the tomb. For 3 days he was in there. And glory be to God, I'm glad. Hallelujah, that he went and he preached to the spirits in prison. Amen, is what the Bible tells me. And glory be to God. The Bible told me that on the third day that Jesus rose from the grave, Jesus conquered. He said, I am he that was dead and am alive forevermore. And I have the keys of death and hell. I'm so glad that Jesus, amen, conquered death. Amen. I'm so glad for who he is. Yeah. He came to save us. You know, it's appointed unto men once to die. And after this, the judgment. Every one of us in here, if the Lord doesn't come back and rapture us first, we're going to die. And amen, the Bible tells me that Jesus is going to descend the Lord himself. I'm glad he's not sending somebody else to do it. The Bible said in 1 Thessalonians 4, the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. I'm so glad, hallelujah, that when Jesus shouts, it's the same voice that shouted and said, Lazarus, come forth. Yeah. Hallelujah. And you know what? Lazarus had been dead 4 days and he came back from the dead. That same voice is going to descend and he's going to shout and he's going to say, come up hither. Woo, glory. It's good to be saved.
Amen.
It's good to be looking forward to going home. This place isn't my home. This place is not our home. We're just sojourners. We're just pilgrims and strangers on the earth. We're just here for a little while. Just a little while. Oh, brother, you can look back and you can see back how it was when you was a little boy. And it just seems like a little while ago. And it goes by ever so fast. Our life is but a vapor.
Yeah.
It appears for a little while. And then it's gone.
That's right.
Amen. I'm glad that Jesus,
amen,
he came to give us life. And life more abundant. Oh, brother, we don't live until we've lived in Jesus. Hallelujah. We're dead in trespasses and in sins. The Bible says, and you hath he quickened who were dead in trespasses and in sins. I'm so glad for a Savior this morning. We look at Luke chapter 15, and we see here about Jesus and how it was this day that Jesus went to eat with publicans and with sinners. So many folks today, I believe, are confused about what church is about and about who Jesus truly was. But glory be to God, I'm so glad for the scriptures. I'm so glad for the word of God. Amen. It's not what a man tells us, but what thus saith the Lord God
That's
Almighty.
Right. That's right.
I'm so glad this morning. The Bible says in Luke 15, in verse 1, then drew near unto him the publicans and sinners for to hear him. And the Pharisees and the scribes murmured, saying, this man receiveth sinners and eateth with them. Let us pray together. Father God, Lord Almighty, in the name of Jesus. Father, what a privilege, Father, that Lord God, that you sent your Son to die for us, Lord. Lord God, even though we were sinners, dear Lord, Christ came and he died for us, Father, not when we were good, not that we were doing things that were right, but that this world needed a Savior. Father, thank you ever so much, Father, for Lord having mercy on us, Father. And Lord, I praise you for your tender love and kindness, Father, that you've shown this world. I pray, Father, help each and every one, dear Lord, that hears your word this morning. Help each and every one of us, Father. Lord God, that we would trust wholly on Jesus. Lord God, that it wouldn't be something that we had done in the past, that it wouldn't be something that we're going to do in the future, but that today is the day of salvation, Lord, that we would draw nigh unto you each and every hour of our life. Father God, Lord, that we would walk with you each and every day, dear Lord, that we live. I pray, Father, send forth your word and accomplish what you sent it to do, Father. And Lord, I give you all the praise and the glory and the honor in Jesus' name. And amen. The Bible says here in Luke 15 that Jesus then drew near unto him all the publicans and sinners for to hear him. And the Pharisees and scribes murmured, saying, this man receiveth sinners and eateth with them. Here the sinners came to Jesus, and the sinners wanted to hear what Jesus had to say. You know, the Bible says that faith comes by hearing. and hearing by the word of God. And the Bible says, and how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach except they be sent? He says, as it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that bring glad tidings of good things. Oh, brother, it's a wonderful thing, amen, to hear the gospel of God Almighty. That's why God lets us come to church. God lets us come to church that it'll strengthen one another's faith, that we can hear of the goodness of God Almighty, that we can hear of the truth of God's word, and that it sinks inside of our heart, and it strengthens us that when the fiery darts of the wicked come, that God's able to quench all of those fiery darts. Amen. The Bible says that that with the shield of faith, it'll quench all of the fiery darts of the wicked. I'm so glad this morning, amen, that Jesus came to save sinners. The Bible tells us here that the Pharisees and the scribes murmured within themselves, and they said, this man, he eats with sinners and with publicans. A publican was a tax collector, and they looked upon a tax collector in those days as someone who was a thief or someone who stole from the poor to give to the rich, and they were murmuring in themselves, saying, this man's supposed to be the Son of God. He calls himself the Son of God. He proclaims to be a prophet, and yet he eats with these publicans and with sinners. But I'm so glad that Jesus came for sinners. That's what Jesus came for. I'm so glad that Jesus came to show us mercy. You know, mercy. I'm so glad that God shows us mercy. You know what mercy truly is? It's not just being forgiven. You see, because if someone would forgive you for something, they'd say, well, I forgive you for that. And they may not bring it back up to you again. But mercy goes beyond forgiveness. Mercy goes beyond someone just simply saying, I forgive you. Mercy is actually saying, I forgive you, and I'm going to actually do something to help you. Amen. That's what mercy is. Mercy is taking forgiveness and putting it into action. Amen. And you see, if you were to go to a court and you were to be tried in court and you say, have mercy on me, plead the mercy of the court. Amen. And the court would say, well, okay, you're forgiven. And they might let you go free. But glory be to God, I'm so glad that God didn't just say, well, you're forgiven, and that's all I'm going to do. Because God, when He shows us mercy, He forgives us of our sin, and then He fills us with His Holy Spirit. He takes us and He fills us with His presence, and He fills us with His love, and He promises us a place prepared in heaven. So God doesn't just say, I forgive you. God says, I'm going to do something about the condition that you're in. Oh, brother, how I love the song, just as I am. I praise God that God takes me just as I am, but God doesn't just leave me just as I am. God takes me and washes me in His own blood and makes me a saint, amen, in the eyes of God. Amen. The Bible says that Christ was made sin for us, He who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God,
amen,
in Him. Oh, not my righteousness, right, not your righteousness, not the righteousness of a pope, not the righteousness of a preacher, the righteousness of God.
That's right.
That's what God sees in those that are saved. You see, the Pharisees, they had their own righteousness. Yes. Romans chapter 10, the Bible said that Paul, he said, my prayer, my heart's desire, and my prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. Yes. He says, for they have a zeal of God, but not according to knowledge. Yes. He says, for they, going about to establish their own righteousness, have not to submit themselves under the righteousness of God, which is by faith. You see, the sinners and the publicans, they heard how Jesus was no respecter of persons. Jesus, it didn't matter to Jesus who it was. If they wanted to be saved, if they wanted the Lord's help, He would help them. He would help them. He might prove their faith. And he might say, well, it's not meet for me to do my works for the dogs. Amen. But the woman, how she said to him, Lord, yea, but the dogs desire the crumbs that fall from the master's table. And he said, I've never seen such great faith. I've never seen such wonderful faith. how the centurion came to him. He was a Gentile. And he says, Lord, I'm not worthy for you to come under my roof and to heal my servant. He says, Lord, just speak the word. He says, I've never seen so great a faith. No, and not in all of Israel. Amen. Because Jesus wanted to help whoever would. Whoever would believe, whosoever. You know, it's the same today. It hasn't changed. He says, I am the Lord. Behold, I change not. Jesus Christ the same today and yesterday and forever. Jesus will always be the same. This world changes and people grow worse, wax worse and worse, and they deceive, and they're going to be deceived. In this world, that because iniquity is going to abound, the love of many will wax cold. This world is getting worse and worse and worse, but God hasn't changed. He's still the same Savior as the day that he hung on the cross. He's still the same Savior as this day when he received publicans and sinners, and they drew near to him to hear him. The Bible tells us many instances where Jesus did this, many times where Jesus had gathered together to had went and fellowshipped with publicans and with sinners. And the Bible says in Luke 19 that Jesus entered and passed through Jericho, and behold, there was a man named Zacchaeus, which was a chief among the publicans, and he was rich, and he sought to see Jesus, who he was, and he could not for the press because he was of little stature. He was just a little man. And there was people all over the place trying to follow Jesus. They wanted to see him. They wanted to get close to him. They had heard of the things that he had done. They had heard how he had made the lame people to walk. How that people who were blind from their very birth, how that he anointed their eyes and they were able to see for the very first time. They had heard how that there was 5,000 men and women and children besides, and a little boy brought in 2 fishes and 5 loaves of bread, and Jesus prayed and he asked his Father in heaven and he thanked his heavenly Father, and God took it and made a miracle out of that and fed over 20,000 people with a little boy's lunch.
Yes, amen.
They wanted to see this man. But here was a little man named Zacchaeus, and he couldn't see over the crowd. So the Bible says that he ran before and climbed up into a sycamore tree to see him, for he was to pass that way. He had faith. No matter what, I'm going to see him. I'm going to do no matter what it takes. And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and saw him and said unto him, Zacchaeus, make haste and come down, for today I must abide at thine house. He said, I'm going to come to your house, Zacchaeus. I'm not going to just pass by, but I'm going to come into your home. You know that's what Jesus wants to do. He doesn't just want us to have fellowship with him once in a while. He wants to live with us every day. He wants to live in our heart. He wants to live in our home. He wants to bless our family. He wants to bless your work. He wants to bless every step that you take. That's what he told Joshua. He said that every place that the sole of your foot shall tread upon, it shall be blessed. Hallelujah. That's what God promises his children.
Amen.
Glory be to God. He made haste, and he came down and received him joyfully. And when they saw it, they all murmured. They said that he was going to be a guest with a man that is a sinner. I'm so glad that Jesus came for sinners. Well, the Bible tells us here, it goes on, and Jesus tells Zacchaeus, this day salvation has come to this house, for so much as he is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which is lost. Wonder why Jesus came? He came to seek you and me. He came to seek and to save that which is lost. I'm so glad that he came looking for me. Aren't you glad? Hallelujah. Zacchaeus thought he went looking for Jesus. No, Jesus came looking for Zacchaeus. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I'm so glad this morning for that. Now, the Bible tells us in Matthew chapter 9, scripture, a couple of them right in a row, the Bible tells us about a man, that was sick of palsy. He had a cerebral palsy. This man couldn't walk. And the Bible says that they brought him a man that was sick of the palsy, lying in a bed. And Jesus, seeing their faith, said unto the sick of the palsy, "Son, be of good cheer. Thy sins be forgiven thee." You see, these people, they brought this man to Jesus, and they couldn't get to him. In Mark chapter 2, the Bible says that they could not draw nigh to him for the press. And when they could not, the Bible says that they uncovered the roof where he was and let down the bed wherein the sick of the palsy lay. In other words, they came to church and it was so packed that they couldn't get in there to see Jesus. And they said, "You know what? Hallelujah. We'll go up on the roof. Hallelujah. We'll go up on the roof and we'll just tear up the roof and we'll just let him out through the roof." And you know what? Jesus said, "Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Looky there." He said, when Jesus saw their faith, he said, Jesus, the Bible said that he said, "Son, thy sins be forgiven thee." But there were certain of the scribes which said within themselves, "This man blasphemeth." And Jesus said, knowing their thoughts, "Wherefore think ye evil in your hearts?" You see, they didn't say it out loud. They didn't say that out loud. They said it in their heart. And Jesus looked on them and he saw what they were thinking. The Word of God is quick and it's powerful. It's sharper than any two-edged sword. It pierces to the dividing asunder of the soul and spirit, and it's a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. Jesus saw their hearts, and he says, "Why do you think evil in your heart? Whether it is easier to say to the sick of the palsy, 'Thy sins be forgiven thee,' or 'Arise, take up thy bed and walk,' but so that you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins, he saith unto the sick of the palsy, 'Arise, take up thy bed, and go thy way into thy house.'" And all that saw it praised and glorified God, because they had never seen it before in this fashion. Oh, brother, they were amazed. They were amazed. He said, "I want you to know." Why did Jesus do the miracles he did? Because he wanted them to know that he had the power to take away their sin. He had the power to forgive their sin. You know that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God? All. Everyone has sinned. Did you know that God doesn't look at little sins and big sins? You know, a little leaven, just as the Lord demonstrated, a little drop, it leavens the whole thing.
Right.
It makes the whole thing sinful. The book of James says that if you keep the law and you offend in one point, you're guilty of all. Mm-hmm. All of it. So in other words, if you tell a lie, or if you covet, you're guilty of murder. You're guilty of adultery. It's just the same. I'm so glad, as my sister says often, for the things that aren't going to be in heaven. I'm so glad that there's not going to enter in anything that defiles.
Amen.
There's not going to be anything that works an abomination. There will not be one sin in heaven. I'm so glad. Hallelujah. The whole earth, amen, is going to be full of his righteousness. Amen. The Bible says that there's going to be the heaven and the earth are going to be new, and it's going to be wherein dwelleth righteousness. I'm so glad. Amen, that there's not going to be sin in heaven. The Bible goes on and it says, "And Jesus passed forth from thence and saw a man named Matthew sitting at the receipt of the custom. And he said, 'Follow me,' and he followed him. And it came to pass that as Jesus sat at meat in his house, behold, many publicans and sinners came and sat down with him and his disciples. And when the Pharisees saw it, they said unto his disciples, 'Why eateth your master with publicans and sinners?' But when Jesus heard that, he said unto them, 'They that be whole need not a physician, but they that are sick.'" In other words, he said, folks that don't need help, I didn't come to help them. I came to help those that need help. You see, God cannot save a person until that person realizes that they're a sinner.
Amen, that's right.
You must realize that you're a sinner. You must realize that's what the law of God teaches us. That's why the law was given. We can see the Ten Commandments over here. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. The first and the great commandment. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart. He said, for I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God. He says, I visit the iniquity of the fathers unto the third and the fourth generation of them that hate me, and I'll show mercy to the thousands of them that love me. You say, well, Brother Troy, I don't worship no other gods. You know what Jesus said? Jesus said, you can't serve God and money. He says, you can't serve two masters. Either you'll love the one or you'll hate the other. He says, you can't serve God and mammon. So, brother, it's either that we're all the way in with Jesus, or we're all the way out. Amen?
Yeah.
Brother, when Noah got into the ark, Noah was either inside of the ark, or the people were outside of the ark. But brother, when they got in the ark, God himself closed the door. And amen, they passed through the flood, and God protected them. And amen, glory be to God, I'm so glad. But amen, that Jesus said, he that is not with me is against me. That's plain and simple. I'm glad Jesus made it black and white. Plain and simple. Amen. He that is not with me is against me. And he that gathereth not with me scattereth abroad. Amen. I'm so glad that Jesus made it very plain. He said, they that behold need not a physician, but those that are sick. But go ye and learn what that meaneth. I will have mercy and not sacrifice. For I am not come to call the righteous, but I've come to call sinners to repentance. Sinners. Those that have failed. Those who realize that they need to be saved. That's what God came for. That's what Jesus came for. He came to seek and to save that which was lost. He came to seek and to save those who need help. I'm so glad, amen, that Jesus is no respecter of persons. You see, it doesn't matter today if you're rich. It doesn't matter if you're poor. It doesn't matter how much money you have. It doesn't matter what kind of car you drive. It doesn't matter what kind of home you live in. Jesus came to save you. And I'm so glad, amen. The Bible tells us in Luke chapter 16 and verse 19 that there was a certain rich man. He was clothed in purple and fine linen. And he fared sumptuously every day. I mean, brother, he was dressed in the finest clothes. And he ate the finest food. And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, which was laid at his gate, full of sores. He wasn't even able to come into the house. And he laid at the gate full of sores. And the Bible says that the dogs came and they licked his sores.
Yeah.
And he desired to be fed from the crumbs that fell from the rich man's table. And the Bible says that it came to pass that the beggar died and was carried by angels into Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died, and in hell he lifted up his eyes, being in torments. And he cried to Father Abraham, and he said, Father Abraham, send Lazarus to cool my tongue, for I'm tormented in this flame. And he says, there's a great gulf between us. And he says, so that those that would pass from thence to here cannot, and neither can we pass from here to thence. And he says, Father, I have five brethren. He says, God, send someone to tell them not to come to this awful place. This is the rich man. In today's society, people look at rich people and they think that because they got a lot of money that God has blessed them and surely they're on their way to heaven. But Jesus didn't preach that. Jesus said that this man trusted in riches instead of trusting in God, and in hell he lifted up his eyes being in torment. And this poor beggar that didn't have nothing, who was laying outside the gate, that he was carried by angels into Abraham's bosom. Jesus, the Bible said that Abraham said to the rich man, he said, son, remember that thou in thy lifetime receivest thy good things, and likewise Lazarus evil things. But now he is comforted, and thou art tormented. Brother, does that mean that I can't be rich? No, that doesn't mean that. That means that if you trust in riches, if you don't trust in God, you'll not see heaven. You'll not get to see my Savior Jesus if you don't trust in what He has done for you. Because He came to save sinners. He came to be a Savior to this world. I'm so glad that Jesus came to be our Savior.
Yeah. Amen.
Oh, I'm so glad. The Bible says in 1 Timothy 1 and 15 that this is a faithful saying. And it's worthy of all acceptation. That Christ Jesus came into this world to save sinners, among whom I am chief. Now that was written from the Apostle Paul to a young pastor named Timothy. That was written by Paul in a letter that he had gave Timothy. And he was helping Timothy to understand the doctrine of Christ. That Christ came to save chance sinners. And Paul said, I am the chiefest of sinners. The Apostle Paul was author of 2/3 of the New Testament. Author of the book of Acts, Romans, 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, Colossians. He was author of all of these books. 1 and 2 Timothy, 1 and 2 Thessalonians, Philemon. He authored these books under the inspiration of the Holy Ghost, and he said, I am the chiefest of sinners. Why was Paul the chiefest of sinners? If you read the book of Acts, the Bible tells us in the book of Acts chapter 7 that they took a deacon of the new church. His name was Stephen. And Stephen was a man full of the Holy Ghost and loved God with all his heart. And they would try to say things against Stephen, but they couldn't resist the words of wisdom that Stephen spoke under the inspiration of the Holy Ghost. And they brought false witnesses against Stephen, just as they did Jesus. And they brought false witnesses, and they arrested him, and they brought him before the court. And when they looked on his face was, as it were, the face of an angel. Glory be to God, and he began preaching in that court. He wasn't, glory be to God, pleading for his life from those sinners. He began preaching all the way from Moses, all the way through. And he says, and you have crucified the Son of God. You've crucified him. He says that you do always resist the Holy Ghost. As your fathers did, so do ye. And the Bible says that they gnashed on him with their teeth. And they took him outside of that court. And they threw him outside of the city. And they stoned him to death. They stoned him to death. The Bible says that as they were stoning the life out of him, he said, Father, I pray. He looked up to heaven. And he said, Father, I pray, lay not this sin to their charge. He says, don't blame them, Father. Ooh, that was Jesus inside of Stephen. The Bible says that Saul was there and he was consenting unto his death. And that he breathed out threatenings. He breathed out threatenings against the Christians. This man named Saul, he was a Pharisee of the Pharisees. A Hebrew of the Hebrews. His entire life, he had tried to keep the law of God. From the time that he was circumcised as a baby of the 8th day of the tribe of Benjamin, he tried to keep the law. But one day, this man who saw was there and he says, stone him to death. He was persecuting Christians. He would take and arrest Christians and pull them out of their houses and take them and torture them and compel them to blaspheme the name of Jesus. That's what this man Saul would do. He would literally torture them until they would blaspheme Jesus' name. That's how wicked this man was. But he was a Hebrew of the Hebrews. He was a Pharisee. He studied under the instruction of Gamaliel, who was a chief master scholar in the law of God. And he took, and this man whose name was Saul was on the road to Damascus one day. And he was going, glory be to God, he was taking letters and he was going to go and persecute more Christians, and all of a sudden a light shined from heaven. And it, brother, it was so bright that it blinded the men that were around. And it called out from heaven and it said, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? He says, who art thou, Lord? He said, I'm Jesus, whom thou persecutest. It's hard for thee to kick against the pricks. And he says, Lord, what would you have me to do? Oh, glory be to God. On that road to Damascus that day, Saul was changed to the name Paul, the Apostle Paul, this man who was wicked, this man who compelled Christians to blaspheme. He was the chiefest of sinners, but God took him and he changed him. And he was no longer a sinner. He was no longer lost. He was found. Jesus came and shined his glory about him and changed him into a glorified vessel for Jesus Christ. You see, that's what God does with sinners. Brother, what good would it be if God took a good person who didn't realize they needed a sinner, but he took someone who realized how wicked and filthy they were. God realized, they realized that they were, that they, without Jesus, they were on their way to a devil's hell. And then that person says, glory be to God. He saved me. He made me new. He has quickened me. He has washed and taken away my sin. That's what John the Baptist said when he saw Jesus. He didn't say that he pushed his sin back for a little bit. That he just covered his sin up to just come back out and show itself again. He said, behold the Lamb of God, which takes away the sin of the world.
Yeah.
That's what he said. Takes away sin. I'm so glad that Jesus takes away sin. Saul was changed, and his name's to the name Paul. And you know the name Paul means small. That's what it means. It means small. And amen. Paul said, the glory be to God. And the Bible tells us that he wrote there in 1 Corinthians 12. He says, when I'm weak, then am I strong. He says, I will glory in my infirmities that the power of Christ may rest upon me. For Christ said that my strength is made perfect in weakness. Listen, if you have a weakness and you have a sin that you struggle with, you have an infirmity that you struggle with, that's where God's going to show his glory and his power in you. He will show his glory and he will show his might and he will show his miracle hand working power in your infirmities. Where you are the weakest, that's where God will show his strength. Aren't you glad for that? Yeah. Amen. He didn't come to help those that are whole. He came to help those that are sick. Oh, yeah. Amen. Yeah. To show his strength and his power. The Bible says that he spake this parable unto them in Luke 15. What man of you, having 100 sheep, if he lose one of them, doth not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after that which is lost until he find it? And when he hath found it, he layeth it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he cometh home, he calleth together his friends and neighbors, saying unto them, rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep which was lost. Jesus said, I say unto you that likewise joy shall be in heaven over one sinner that repenteth, more than over 99 just persons which need no repentance. He says, joy shall be in heaven. Heaven rejoices over one sinner. Or what woman, having 10 pieces of silver, if she lose one piece, doth not light a candle and sweep the house and seek diligently till she find it? And when she hath found it, she calleth her friends and her neighbors together, saying, rejoice with me, for I have found the peace which I had lost. Likewise, I say unto you that there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner that repents. You know, when you repent and you come to God, there's no greater thing that can happen in your life. It is the greatest miracle. The greatest miracle that ever happens. You say, Brother Troy, how is it a miracle? Well, Nicodemus had that problem. when he came to Jesus. He was a Pharisee. And Jesus told him, he says, "Marvel not that I said unto thee, you must be born again." Brother, you're born the first time by your mommy. You're born the first time. But Jesus said, "That which is of the flesh is flesh, and that which is of the spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I said, you must be born again of the Spirit of God." And Jesus explained to Nicodemus that God sent his Son. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Jesus explained that to him, and that he could be born of the Spirit of God. It's the greatest miracle. It's the greatest miracle ever known to man, to be born of the Spirit of God, to be a child of God. There's wonderful, wonderful promises far beyond anything that you could ever attain in yourself. Far beyond anything that any other man can ever give you through being a child of God. You see, the Bible says here, it goes on and it says that a certain man had two sons. He had two boys. And the younger boy said to his father, he said, "Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me." In other words, he wanted his inheritance now. "I want what I got coming to me now." I think that this younger son had it in his mind that maybe even if his daddy would die, he could get what was his daddy's so he could have what he wanted. He said to his father, "Give me the portion of goods that falleth to me." And the father relented, and he gave him the portion of goods that fell to him through inheritance. And not many days after, the Bible says that the younger son, that he took his journey into a far country. And there he wasted everything that he was given with riotous living. And the Bible says that he had spent, after he had spent all that he had, after he'd spent all of his inheritance, the Bible says that he began to be in want. You know, there's pleasure in sin for a little while. For a little while, there's pleasure in sin. But the Bible tells me in Psalm 16 that at the right hand of God there are pleasures forevermore.
Amen.
There's pleasure in sin for a little while, and it'll last for a season, just as it did for this young man. But after a while, it runs out. And the Bible says that he went and he joined himself to a citizen of that country. And that citizen of that country, who was a Gentile, who was a sinner, he began working for a sinner. He sent him into his field to feed swine, to feed pigs. That was his job, was to go out there and slop the hogs. It was a terrible, nasty, filthy job. And the Bible says that he was so poor, and here he had had his inheritance and he had wasted it, and he says, he would have fain have filled his belly with the husk that the swine did eat. The slop that the pigs were eating and things, he wanted to eat what they had. That's how hungry he was.
Yeah.
He was so hungry, he was sitting there thinking, "Boy, that's awful nasty, but I'm starving hungry. And I'd love to have something to eat. Oh, my belly hurts." He would have fain have filled his belly with the husk that the swine did eat. But no man gave unto him. They went ahead and gave it to the hogs instead. And the Bible says that when he came to himself, in other words, when he realized the predicament that he had got himself in, he said, "How many hired servants of my father that I left and I took my inheritance from, who I wished were dead in my heart that I could just have what I wanted. How many hired servants of my father's back home, they have bread enough to spare, and I'm perishing with hunger." He says, "I know what I'll do." He said, "I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to rise. I'm tired. I'm wore out. But I'm going to rise and I'm going to go to my father. And I'll say, 'Father, I've sinned against heaven and before thee. And I'm no more worthy to be called your son. Make me as one of your servants. Father, I'd rather serve you than I would back here with the hogs.'" So he came, the Bible says that he arose and he came to his father. And no doubt he imagined He was thinking in his heart that when he came to his father, that his father would probably be wroth with him. That his father would probably give him a hard time and say, "Boy, didn't I tell you so, son?" But the Bible says he came to his father. But his father was looking for him.
Amen. Sure. Yeah.
And he saw him a great way off.
Yeah.
And the Bible says he ran to him. He ran. And he fell on his neck. And he kissed him. And the son said, "Father, I have sinned against heaven. And in thy sight, I'm no more worthy to be called your son." He didn't even get to say the next part. He didn't even get to say, "Make me as a servant." The Bible said that his father said to the servants, he said, "Bring the best robe and put it on him. Then put a ring of royalty on his hand and put shoes on his feet and bring him the fatted calf and let us kill it and eat. For this my son was dead and he's alive again. He was lost and now he's found." I tell you that when you get saved, there's joy in the presence of God's angels in heaven, and God himself rejoices over you being saved. There's no greater thing that can happen in your life than knowing that God loves you and accepting what he did for you on the cross and be born again and become a son of the living God.
Amen.
There's nothing greater. Nothing greater that can happen in your life. Let's all stand, if you would. Turn to 127 in the Red Book. If you're here this morning and you'd like to just tell Jesus that you love him and you're thankful for what he did, won't you come this morning? Maybe you're not positive of your salvation. You can come and you can be positive of your salvation. God is looking for you just like you are. You don't need to change. You don't need to try and wait till another time. This is the time. This is the day of salvation.
Follow the way of God.
you glad that that's the way the Lord is looking for us? Just as we are. I'm so thankful for him this morning. Are y'all thankful for Jesus this morning? Isn't it exciting to be saved? Amen. I'm so thankful for Brother Roger and Sister Maria and y'all youngins and Tommy. And I'm just thankful. I praise the Lord for everybody this morning. It's a privilege to come and fellowship with everyone and for us to get to worship God together. Anybody have anything that you want to say? Everybody's mind and heart clear. Anything to say? Well, come on up. Let's praise the Lord. Y'all are welcome to come too. You want to praise the Lord? That's all. Brother Jim, would you lead us?
Praise the Lord for his mercy and endureth forever. Praise the Lord for his mercy and endureth forever. Praise